And it is a very heartening thing that this judgment came from the lowest of the courts, which is a very welcome thing. You know, every time, in fact, now we find that to get bail, one does not get bail till, especially in sensitive cases or even slightly media important cases, until the person approaches the Supreme Court. And every time, I'm sorry to say, that the court will always say, you know, there will be that very famous line which says, bail is the rule and jail is an exception. Every judgment of, I would say, on bail has this line, but it is something which is not followed by anyone. Till the person has languished in jail for a couple of months or, and for, in my mind, even for a day, if he does deserves bail, is wrong. Rebecca is, of course, one of our foremost criminal lawyers of the country. She has made a mark in a male-dominated field, which in itself is a big feat. Rebecca, today, a lot of people are asking questions around what is happening with Disha's case. And people want to know as to why, how can this happen? Could you throw some light on what is the law of arrest in our country and how is it supposed to operate? Because we know, we've seen that in Disha's case, there were a lot of procedural lapses which occurred. And so if you could just, you know, maybe explain, because a lot of our viewers, yes, most of them are lawyers, but there are some non-lawyers also who have joined in. And it would be a good thing for them to really know what is the law on arrest?
Thank you, Manali. So this is, as you know, the CRPC has cognizable, non-cognizable offenses, bailable offenses, non-bailable offenses. The young lady in question has been charged for cognizable and non-bailable offenses. Was, as you know, picked up from Bangalore last Saturday by a team of Delhi police officers. Because they were cognizable offenses, they don't necessarily need a warrant of arrest, and they can arrest her without a warrant. And she was arrested. She was then brought to Delhi. The police claims, and rightly so, that she was produced within 24 hours, which was in compliance of Section 57 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. And therefore, there was no violation of Section 57. But I have pleaded on several forums that the police ought to have taken a transit remand. I know there is a bit of a debate on this, but there is a Delhi High Court Division Bench judgment, which clearly says that when you pick up people from outside your jurisdiction, you should actually produce that person before the court of jurisdiction, before the court within whose jurisdiction she resides. And the police ought to have taken that transit remand. They produced her in Delhi on a Sunday. She was made to plead her own case. There was only a legal aid lawyer who I'm told did not have even the FIR with him. And she was remanded to 5 days police custody. She had a lawyer of choice because at the time of her arrest, the Delhi police did call him up and inform him that they were arresting her from Bangalore. So I don't understand why that lawyer of choice was not informed about the place and time when she was going to be produced. In fact, she was produced today as well. And there was the same craziness that happened today with lawyers not knowing where she would be produced because the chief metropolitan magistrate was on leave today. And so the same confusion happened today. Mercifully, her lawyer did appear. These are the kind of procedural safeguards that exist. Now, the Delhi High Court 2019 judgment passed by Justice Muralidhar and Justice Talwant Singh clearly stated that if you are arresting someone from outside your jurisdiction, then firstly, the arrested person must be given an opportunity to consult his lawyer before he's taken out of the state. And secondly, the endeavor should be made to obtain transit remand after producing the arrestee before the nearest magistrate, unless exigencies of the situation warrant otherwise. There was also a remark that the magistrate before whom the arrestee is produced must apply his mind to the facts of the case and should not grant transit remand mechanically. Justice Gupta said, and rightly so, that remand is a judicial function. In fact, remand is the first important function a magistrate performs in a criminal case post-arrest. A couple of months ago, a set of clients came to me saying that I must, it was a second or third remand, but the first 15 days had not lapsed, and that I should oppose further remand of a client who had been arrested in connection with the Delhi riots case. When I looked at the FIR, I saw that all the offenses were bailable. And I said, you know, have further offenses been added to this case? What is the problem? Because these are bailable offenses. Why is this person being remanded? And they said we don't think so. So I asked them to check the remand application, the last remand application, and no further offenses had been added. So I asked this young lawyer to file a bail, to inform the court who was remanding this individual that these offenses were bailable and therefore bail should have been given as a matter of right. After 8 days in custody, the magistrate realized that the offenses for which this individual was being remanded were bailable offenses and obviously had to release the accused on bail. This is the kind of lack of application of mind that takes place at this stage. And I cannot emphasize enough the need for magistrates to carefully look at FIRs, to carefully look at case diaries. Our High Court rules and orders obligates a magistrate to look at case diaries, to see the nature of investigation, whether further remand is needed or not. The structure of the CRPC is you must complete investigation within 24 hours. If you do not complete investigation within 24 hours, then you take the accused, the arrestee, to the nearest magistrate. And then the whole process under 167 begins, where you remand people for 15 days at a time for a maximum of 60 or 90 days, depending upon the facts of the case and the seriousness of the offense. And at the end of 60 or 90 days, an accused is entitled to be released on statutory bail if the police does not complete investigation. So why is it that intrinsically and fundamentally judicial functions like remand functions are treated so casually? How is it that an individual who is arrested under bailable sections wrongly by the police is then remanded for 8 days, and this is happening in Delhi, not in some obscure corner of India, is remanded for 8 days without the magistrate realizing that these were bailable offenses. So I think procedurally, we have when we emphasize that there is need to adhere to procedure, it is because personal liberty is intrinsically linked with procedural law. And if you do not follow procedural law, there will be a great breach in liberty. There will also be a great breach in the right of that individual to a fair trial. Moving on the issue of laws like sedition, Justice Gupta talked about the law of sedition, but I would also bring in offenses like the offenses under the UAPA Act, which are now increasingly used for purposes of putting behind bars people that the state does not want to deal with. They can be academics, they can be students, they can be public policy experts, they can be actually the foremost citizens of this country, but they are put behind bars indefinitely under UAPA. And why is that so? It is because of the stringent regime within UAPA. There is an overlap between sedition laws as well as UAPA, but UAPA defines terrorist activities under Section 15, and those are inherently violent physical acts. And yet you see people who have made a speech somewhere or people who have expressed dissent with respect to any policy of the government or any statement made by the government, pushed in under this law. And what does this law do to that individual? It permits the state to seek maximum custody of 180 days as opposed to 90 days under general law. It makes bail a virtual impossibility because of the stringent provisions of bail under 43D5. Because of these exceptions, because these exceptions have become the norm, it becomes virtually impossible for a person tagged with UAPA to come out on bail. Why is bail treated as the be-all and end-all of criminal law? I would say everybody is entitled to bail. You prove your case. If at the end of the trial you feel somebody is guilty of an offense, certainly convict that person and punish that person to whatever sentence that person deserves. But why do we celebrate pre-trial incarceration in this manner? Why are courts so hesitant to grant bail? As a criminal lawyer, today I feel the minute a person gets bail, the case is over, because that is the kind of importance we give to bail proceedings. I would think that, like the rest of the world, bail should be a right, jail should be the exception. That was the law on which we all built our practice. But today, bail is the exception, and jail seems to be the right of prosecuting agencies. I think I've gone far beyond your question, Manali, but the question you asked was, what are the laws on arrest and remand? This, in short, is really the law on arrest and remand.
In short.
Thank you, Rebecca. Also, I was just wondering if you could also, you know, speak.
It's not because my phone is there, because the connectivity is like.
You know, in the trends you see nowadays in the criminal justice system. I know you've spoken a little bit about it, but this is a matter of great concern, because case after case we are finding that, there is a disproportionate use of and an excessive use of laws. So technically everything is done legally, so to say. But, you know, for a cartoon or for a joke or for a, you know, we are finding that we have the most extreme laws which are now being, used to silence dissent of any kind.
You're absolutely right that as a lawyer, of late, what I'm doing is looking at articles written by journalists, because they actually now seek legal opinion before they even publish those articles, just in case they are not violating any laws. I've had senior journalists send me their tweets before they put it out. Now, what kind of regime is this? Surely we have thicker skin than that, that we can look at criticism more constructively. Even if the criticism is extreme, and they can be criticism which is extreme, so what? Don't forget that internationally, England, for example, the Scottish independence movement, it was settled through a referendum where the entire state participated, and finally it was decided that Scotland would stay with England. Similarly, in the 1990s, there was this movement in Canada where Quebec tried to secede, and again, it was settled through a very narrow referendum. Referendums, whether you want to remain part of a union, I mean, these are extreme cases. Even that can be done in a civilized, cultured way. Here, we're only talking about individuals or organizations who are putting out a critique against the establishment. Why should that be treated as something which is not palatable, as something which is against the state, as something which is anti-national? I think some of us who speak for the vulnerable sections of society, be it Adivasis, be it women, be it people belonging to the scheduled tribes or scheduled castes, We are performing a deeply patriotic function. Why should these people be put in? It is because we care that we are talking about individuals who are not getting the attention from the state, so to speak. India is a diverse country. We have states, union territories, multiple languages. Surely that diversity needs to be celebrated. Why should everybody think the same way, dress the same way, act in the same way? What is this normality that we have now produced, that everything should be identical? Why should I be the identical being as the next person, as a person next to me? Why can't I be different? In 1 year's time, my hair, the color of my hair has changed. And so what? So why is it that we insist that people should talk one language, people should talk one in one narrative, people should not criticize the government? And I find it disturbing that beyond a point, we are not getting leadership from courts, particularly superior courts, who should intervene and who should say that this must stop now. The Constitution protects all these individuals, and free speech is protected. And so long as what you're saying does not have a direct relationship with violence or has a tendency to incite violence, we are not going to allow our citizens to be incarcerated in this manner.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think I also feel that a time has come that a strong message must go, and that message can only go from the top, you know, and until and unless that happens, maybe we will see a continuing trend of what has been happening. And with that, we now come to Chitranshul Sinha, who has written a book on sedition, which is called The Great Repression. Chitranshul, your book couldn't have come at a more appropriate time. I think you published it somewhere around 2019. You have traced the history of law of sedition and its introduction by Lord Macaulay in 1837. And I just wonder, you know, how, considering it has now, the law of sedition has either been toned down or struck off in many countries, why and how it has still a place in our statute. This is something, and it's only laws like this which actually empower governments, and it's not just this present dispensation. The misuse of such laws has been universal by all governments and all dispensations. So we would really like you to explain to all the people who are here today what the law of sedition really is. Please start with that, and you know, because a lot of people don't know, and a lot of people feel that, you know, because there is a law like this, it's okay for the government to use such a law.
So, like Rebecca Ma'am and Justice Gupta already pointed out, this law was not brought into the original IPC in 1860. When Lord Macaulay brought in this was a different section altogether, and it was a part of the draft IPC. But it never saw the light of the day till 1860. And even then, the law against sedition did not find a place till 1870. That was only when Stephens brought in section 124A, replicating what Lord Macaulay had said. It was then only brought into the IPC. And even then, the first trial under section 124A only happened in 1891. So it took 21 years to even invoke the provision for the first time. And that too happened in a case where the Bangobasi, which was a Bengali publication, it published an article criticizing the Age of Consent Act, claiming that the British government is attacking Hindu customs and the Hindu religion. So they prosecuted them for sedition. Then the trial didn't go anywhere, and finally they had to end the trial. But That is where the entire problem started, because what the court then said is that 124A has to be very strictly interpreted. What they said is that, like, I'll just read the terms from here. The terms are any words or visible representation which brings or attempts to bring into hatred or contempt, excites or attempts to excite disaffection towards the government established by law. Now, these terms are extremely wide. And the jurisprudence of that time, which we saw in Tilak's sedition trial also, they just literally interpreted it, said that disaffection would just mean hatred. Disloyalty would just mean hatred. So if you don't have love for the government, you have hatred for the government. And that is good enough to invoke 124A against you. This was followed throughout the colonial independence movement. A lot of leaders, Nehru, Gandhi, Azad, Tilak twice, third time he was not convicted, but this went on for ages. And it was only in 1938 when in the Nirendu Datta Mazumdar case, when the court said that mere causing disaffection or speaking something is not enough to invoke 124A, it must have a direct link to incitement of violence against the government. Now, this position was again overturned by the Privy Council in a subsequent case in 48, which was the Sadasiv Bhale Rao case. Now, though the Constituent Assembly debated this, it was brought into as a restriction on free speech into the draft Article 13, which later became Article 19. And it's already been said how it was opposed, and it was eventually dropped from as a restriction from a fundamental right, from the fundamental rights. It still remained on the statute book. 124A, even throughout till Kedarnath was decided, it was very strictly interpreted. One High Court, Allahabad High Court, Patna High Court, they all had different interpretations of the law, whether incitement to violence is a key ingredient or not, which was finally settled in Kedarnath when the court said that only when such words, representations, actions cause or incite public disorder, then 124A can be invoked. Like Justice Gupta was initially mentioning that the term violence and public disorder, there's a distinction between that. The court said public disorder. Now that term public disorder is extremely wide. It's very broad, because when you look at the provision, it falls under the chapter of offenses against the state. Now, if a group of people raise slogans against the government and go and break a few hoardings near a park or just overturn a few benches, that technically is public disorder. But is that sedition? It's not. Nobody in their right mind can claim it to be sedition. Unless and until the integrity of the state, unless and until the sovereignty of the country is in question, till then it is just a stretch of imagination to even think that 124A can be imposed. However, this Kedarnath judgment is not being followed by any police authorities, any courts. They're not going by the spirit of the judgment. Even in Balwant Singh, which Justice Gupta mentioned, mere slogan shouting cannot be considered sedition. And now we are seeing that in a case in UP, Kashmiri students watching a cricket match supported Pakistan, they were booked for sedition. In a case where intellectuals wrote a letter against lynching, mob lynching, there was FIR filed against in a place like Muzaffarpur for sedition. So today, it's an offense against the state, but we see individuals coming forward claiming that the state is feeling threatened because of acts of certain individuals. Is our democracy that brittle? I'm sorry, it's not. Whatever anyone might say, this democracy is not that brittle that actions of an individual or even organizations fighting for tribal rights, like the Thoothukudi matter where they demanded a nuclear power plant should not be set up. All these people are just exercising the fundamental right of expressing their opinion, of protesting. This does not bring our nation, bring our republic into any sort of danger of disintegrating. Unless and until such an act leads to something which attacks our integrity, till then 124 should not be imposed. And in fact, a few years back, PIL was filed when Justice Deepak Mishra was the Chief Justice. And the petitioner requested that certain guidelines be laid down for state authorities when in imposing Section 124A. But the court simply said that Kedarnath principles to be followed. That literally does not say anything at all. Nobody is going to follow something which is like you have to follow this judgment, and that judgment does not lay down any guidelines. In the Asim Trivedi case, the Bombay High Court actually set down a very good set of guidelines. In that case, they said that before anyone is, even a FIR is registered or investigations begin, the law officer or a senior police official should give a report saying why Section 124A should be invoked in a certain case. But such a guideline is only applicable to Maharashtra. It comes from the Bombay High Court. But other states do not have any such guidelines. Like Rebecca ma'am said, UAPA, it just repeats Section 124A and just makes it even more stringent. And not just about UAPA, it's also the NSA. It's there was the PSA in Jammu and Kashmir. There, people are held for having an opinion and you don't even get a trial. I keep saying this, and Rebecca ma'am will remember this, that I said that the punishment here is not in the provision itself or even after trial. The punishment here is in the procedure. The punishment here is you can simply be arrested on anyone's FIR. It's not the state. In most cases, even the state does not initiate a case. It's individuals who go around filing FIRs against the people. And where in severe cases, when cases of rape, murder, the police is reluctant to register FIRs, they just go ahead and register an FIR if someone's raised a slogan in Nehru Park against the government. So the thing is that there's this provision of sanction under Section 196. The state sanction before any charges are framed in a case of under 124A. But no such safeguard exists at the time of the actual FIR or at the time of arrest. There's no safety valve. This law, if it has to remain on the statute book, and which I seriously believe it should not, in today's society it should not, but if it has to remain, there have to be safety valves in place. Even at the time of arrest, there should be a procedure of sanction. No individual can be allowed to go ahead and file FIRs. It's only the state which should initiate proceedings, if at all. And until and unless an act directly threatens the state, 124A should not be invoked. I just want to repeat something that Justice Gupta said last year at a lecture to the SCBA. He made an extremely important point. I just want to quote Justice Gupta on that. He said that the right to dissent is the biggest right and the most important right granted by the Constitution. And he also said there can be no democracy without dissent. I must add something to that. I feel dissent is not just our right. Dissent is also a duty.
Correct.
The government is for the people. We elect the government to serve us. The master-servant relationship exists where the citizens are masters of the government. However, we feel today that patriotism, or people like to term it nationalism, is when you just simply support the government on everything. That should not be the case. Just like, if I can draw this parallel, the government is like a service provider. We elect the government to provide the country a service. Will you not raise questions when your service provider provides efficient services? Can someone be sent to jail for saying that someone is deficient in performing their duty? A patriot dissents, a nationalist places. That is the distinction that I want to make here today.
Chitranshu, I don't think anyone could have put it better. And I wholeheartedly agree with you. I think a time has come, as Justice Gupta also said, that we have to have slightly thicker skins. We have to be tolerant. We have to show some sort of, resilience to this kind of a thing. We can't just jump up. We can't have the state up against its citizens all the time. I would now request Arundhati to just please take over and give the vote. Before that, I think the question and answer, I'm so sorry. We have also some time which we had kept for questions and answer. Arundhati, please, if you could.
Thank you so much. So, Chitranshu, thank you very much for that very clear explanation of how the law on sedition developed. Let me start by asking you two questions. So how has sedition, we've understood how sedition operated in Britain and how it was actually incorporated in India. And of course, many of these laws that were criminal laws that were codified in India were much more stringent in this kind of experiment that was being done in the colonies. I mean, that is actually the perception with which the Code of 1860 was originally introduced to be a colonial statute on a native population that was to be controlled. But how do other democracies use sedition laws today, or do they use sedition laws? You know, how do they deal with these questions of dissent against the state? And as a kind of related question, why is it that when India became independent, we continued with these laws and other statutes like ASPA, for instance, on the statute books at this moment, which was such a, you know, a moment which was a transformative moment constitutionally, but was not such a transformative moment in terms of criminal justice. Yeah. So why is it that we continued with criminal laws on the statute books, and how would we now see these pre-colonial, pre-independent statutes, especially in light of Justice Nariman's finding in a five-judge bench that there is no presumption of constitutionality now for pre-independent statutes?
Yeah. See, the problem is that even in England, the law wasn't codified like it was in India. IPC was the first codified statute in any of its colonies. Now, even the law of sedition there, like Justice Gupta said, it was a misdemeanor. Why they had to bring it here was, it's very apparent, because it was because of the freedom movement. In fact, sedition, the 124A, the most proximate cause of incorporating 124A into the IPC was because of the Wahhabi movement. It was a Muslim fundamentalist movement, which was the most proximate cause of bringing it in. And it gradually died out, so they never had to invoke it against them. Now, I would like to say that this 124A was not removed from statute books because it's a very useful tool for any government. It's a very useful tool for any party which comes into power. Today, a national party might say that they oppose sedition, but when they had an opportunity, they did not repeal it. In fact, the UAPA was made more stringent by the UPA, by including terrorist activities into the UAPA. So it's a very, very, very easy tool to suppress dissent, to create that fear psychosis in people's minds. Like we are talking here today, when one of my friends received this this poster about the event, he sent me a text asking me, should I draft the bail application right away? So this fear psychosis which has been created, this is a very important tool for that. UAPA, NSA, sedition, this is a tool. So that is why I do not think that any government will take it away. They might water it down, but till the time other stringent provisions that mirror 124A remain, it will always remain a tool. Now, as far as the constitutionality aspect is concerned, one attempt has already been made, and I feel it's, after Justice Nariman's judgment, it's high time that 124A needs to be challenged again. You cannot have the same offense in two places. You cannot invoke 124A and also invoke UAPA. I'm not saying that UAPA, this provision UAPA is very nice and it should remain. I'm saying you have to remove it altogether. We need that space to express our opinion. If we do not receive that space, then the rights granted to us under Article 19, they become redundant. So this needs to be challenged in light of Justice Nariman's opinion now.
Chitranshul, only one point I'd like to say, that if you're in jail this time round, you'll have very good company, because all of us will be with you.
And I hope I have Rebecca ma'am to represent me at least.
she'll also be there with us.
And just to add to the constitutional challenge, I do believe earlier this week a petition was filed, a PIL was filed before the Honorable Supreme Court. Unfortunately, that was dismissed, saying, come to us with a better case.
People without focus go and challenge, it becomes a problem. And there should be a proper organized, structured attempt to challenge the law. It cannot be busybody going ahead and filing a PIL. Yeah. Someone with locus should go. They will have a better right. In fact, why go to the Supreme Court? Go to the High Court first.
I mean, what I'm saying is that, unfortunately, 124A seems to be a case of missed opportunities when it comes to constitutional challenges.
Absolutely. I'm sorry, I had another answer to she also asked about the countries. So countries, it's India is in extremely good company because countries like Saudi Arabia, Iran, Sudan, Malaysia, Turkey, Bangladesh, Pakistan, they still have sedition on their books and they keep imposing it.
And actually, it would be interesting, you know, as a study to see which of those are in fact post-colonial countries and which of those are countries where, you know, codes which are similar to the Indian Penal Code were introduced, because so many of these statutes are actually a legacy of colonialism, which, as you said, we have held on to after independence. So with that, I'm going to pass the mic to Swati to open the floor for so that the audience can ask questions of our speakers. Thank you.
We already have, we are flooded with questions actually in the chat box. And the first question is from Nidhi Parashar. Nidhi, would you like to ask yourself or would you ask? No? Okay. So the first question is for Justice Gupta. Can one solution to abuse of law of sedition be applicability of the principle of Arnesh Kumar to cases of sedition which did not result in violence or public disorder? Sir.
Could you repeat that? I've not really understood the question.
Yes, sir. Can one solution to abuse of law of sedition be applicability of the principle of Arnesh Kumar to cases of sedition which did not result in violence or public disorder?
See, if there's no call incitement for violence to violence or public disorder, in my view, there's no sedition. It's not really the Arnesh Kumar. I feel the very concept of what is sedition, even if we have the law as it is today, as explained in Kedarnath Singh and also amplified in Balwant Singh's case. If we look at that and the judges understand what it is, and as unfortunately when Rebecca was speaking, most of the time I couldn't hear her because there was some glitch. And but what Chitranshul has been saying, that, you know, it's not only the procedure. One, I go at the very root, the not the procedure, but the very basis of the law itself. In my view, the law, even if not unconstitutional, it has to be read in the way in which it was said in Kedarnath in case that there has to be incitement to violence. If there is no violence involved, if there is no, like I gave you the other example of Balwant Singh case where slogans were raised, which were actually anti-national slogans, but the Supreme Court said that it is not. Now, why are our police and these authorities not trained in that you can't have sedition everywhere? But unfortunately, it has become the, in the last 4 or 5 years, it has become the norm that anybody can file a case anywhere. Thank you.
Swati, can I just add to that, please? If you look at 124A, look at the range of punishments in 124A.
Up to 3 years.
You have life imprisonment, you have 3 years, and you have or fine, you know? So potentially somebody can get a life sentence, somebody can get sentence up to 3 years, or even let off on fine. So I think this itself shows this wide range of punishment you have in 124A is itself quite arbitrary. And how do you guide a judge as to what kind of punishment you should give in a particular case? And coming to Arnesh Kumar, I think perhaps that question is a little ill-informed, because Arnesh Kumar would apply for the 7-year embargo offenses. And when you're looking at something which is punishable up to life, so those guidelines may not be.
No. Ma'am, my question was, should a constitutional court say that some kind of guidelines like
in the like Arnesh, of similar to
should be made so that abuse by the government.
You're absolutely right. You're absolutely controlled. You're absolutely right.
If I may just add to what Rebecca ma'am was saying, that imprisonment up to life, it actually replaced a term saying transportation up to life or up to a certain period. Now they simply mindlessly replace it by imprisonment up to life, because alternative to transportation up to life was 3 years imprisonment in India. So that was just a mindless replacement, to be honest.
Right. Thank you. The next question, Chitranshul, that's for you. Should sedition be solely the prerogative of the state, and individuals need to be excluded from being complainants?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So no one can just walk into a police station and file a FIR saying that I feel this is an offense against the state. The state has to take a call whether it's an offense or not, and that too based on guidelines, very stringent guidelines, not simply that a bureaucrat will wake up in the morning and feel that this is something which hurts the state. There have to be extremely stringent guidelines, if at all the law should remain. I keep giving the caveat that the law should go altogether.
Vivekam, ma'am, the next one's for you. It says, why is there a lack of judicial activism in countering the current situation?
Judicial activism. So I did say that I'm looking forward to judicial leadership. I'm not sure whether the word judicial activism is the right word to use, but judicial leadership from constitutional courts. And if that leadership was there, if there's a strong judgment from the Supreme Court, which says that, you know, this is absolutely wrong. You cannot invoke 124A. You cannot mindlessly invoke provisions of the UAPA or other such acts. That message will permeate downwards. I think if you give them latitude, any government or any police force will use that and will use it to its advantage. Laws essentially must punish something which is deeply offensive or deeply violent. You know, in this case, if you're seeking to punish violence, then there must be violence, but your law can't be violent. I think UAPA itself is a violent act. It punishes thought, it punishes speech, it punishes what you haven't said. The poor cartoonist didn't make the joke, and yet he was in custody. What is it? Are you going to enter our minds? Are you going to decide what we are going to speak, at what time we will speak, and what we are speaking in closed doors? So that cannot be the intent of a law. So I believe that these laws themselves are violent. They are not parallelly punishing people who are violent because they have not committed any violence.
Okay. Next question is from Fauzia. She says, do you think it will silence people if bail becomes a fight and jail becomes a right and put all of us on mute instead of voices, or will the voices be louder?
For whom?
Sir?
For me?
Okay. Sir, just a good point.
Yeah, see, somebody remarked, I think Singhal remarked that she was very young when the emergency was imposed. I was studying law. I was in law school in Delhi during the emergency. And I think those 19 months of repression, which were harsher than what the regime is now, I won't say that this is, that was harsher. You just couldn't think of speaking. That pent up emotion came up out after 19 months, and we know what the result was. So I don't think that when you repress, it helps the government in the long run. But having said that, that does not give them any right to repress. You cannot repress voices. You should not. She's right. Fauzia is right when she says that if jail becomes the rule, then voices will be silent. Today, I was just reading somewhere that Friday for the Future, a lot of parents are telling the children, don't go there.
Yeah.
See, the parents are worried that tomorrow my child may be... and they're not going for anything else. They're going for an environment. They're not talking about anything else but the environment. So this fear has become. When last year, a couple of years back, my daughters went out for some, supporting some demonstrations and all. We were worried. So it is not that one is not worried. This worries us when times like this. And I think I don't see... Because in my view, democracy is where the people should have faith in the government, not fear of the government. When we have fear of the government, it is not a democracy.
Well said, sir.
There's an observation which has come, which says, overburdened judicial officers are not able to work as an officer, but just as a clerk, viewing the workload of lower judiciary.
No, I think that's, I'll answer that without, because I have, I don't agree with that at all. You train your officers well, your judicial academies train them well. If they train them well, it is Pandey at the lowest level who gave the judgment in Priya Ramani's case. It is Dharminder Rana who said day before yesterday about sedition, a very correct view of sedition. It is not that, in fact, I have great hope from the members of the trial court judiciary.
Yeah.
district court judiciary. I never call it the subordinate judiciary. I've never used the word subordinate for them. But the district judiciary, I have great hope for them. Because I've seen the quality in the last 7-8 years, especially after the tests have become tougher, is much better. But what they still, what we need to do with them is, one is in the academy, train them very well. The academies, unfortunately, most academies, I'll say, there are some very good judicial academies, they just get into the law school mode of training, you know, teaching them the subjects again, whereas it should be a more professional training. How to deal, I mean, nobody even bothers with Section 167. Right. And I, whenever I've gone to an academy, I've said it's a constitutional duty. Remember, it's a constitutional duty. You're taking away the liberty of a citizen. And if you instill that in the magistrate, he feels, I'm like the High Court, I'm performing a constitutional duty. Not limited, let me look at it more carefully. See, it's not, it's just a sensitivity. A great deal has to be with the sensitivity with which you deal. It's not that we don't have, you know, and I again repeat what I said. Yes, I've been saying for the last few days, let's not tarnish the entire judiciary with one brush. You'll do more harm to this movement by tarnishing the entire judiciary because of some aberrations. There are good judgments coming, there are bad judgments coming. This will always happen. It has happened earlier, it has happened during the emergency. Today, you see, I just give those totally off the out of context, but today's a couple of judges made remarks in praising somebody, which I don't support, but a hue and cry was raised. 20 years back when the J1 of the Supreme Court wrote a letter to the elected prime minister and said there is a rosy glow in the horizon. Nobody said anything. So there's a counter also. We must remember, let's have faith in the judiciary. I also feel sometimes that it's not working to the best what we would expect it to. And I hope more from the superior courts, from the high courts and the constitutional courts rather, that they will come up one day and say that yes, this cannot be done. And I think the time has come when, sometimes you have to grab a case and say, this is where I'm going to pass this on.
And so if I can just add on to that, I can see Tara Narula and others on this group. During the CAA protest, the anti-CAA protest, there were many people who were being picked up, sometimes juveniles. They knocked at the doors of the Chief Metropolitan Magistrate, Metropolitan Magistrates at 12 o'clock at night. And they came out with orders saying not a single juvenile can be kept in judicial or in police custody, and they have to be released immediately. These orders were passed at midnight by these magistrates. So I think the magistracy has also proved to this country time and again, perhaps not as much as superior courts, that they do follow the law. If they are overburdened, that is not really their fault. And sometimes because they are overburdened, they could be oversight. But we've also seen remarkable instances where the magistracy has upheld the law and has made sure that the law has been followed. I would agree with you there that our judges at the district level and the magisterial courts sometimes are actually the best upholders of the law.
Yes, ma'am. Next question, interestingly, is for you, ma'am, Rebecca, ma'am. Targeting people for the dissent is more often indirect counterblast FIRs for some other stray acts. Since a judge cannot travel beyond a case file and speculate a surrounding circumstances to the real reason, how do we tackle this kind of targeting?
See, I've always maintained an FIR must disclose the commission of an offense, right? In most of the cases that we're dealing with now, just 2 weeks ago, you saw that a bunch of journalists had 10 FIRs registered against them in the space of 24 hours in different states of the country for tweeting something, for reporting something that was happening on the ground. The police had a different version. Whether that version is right or wrong, I'm not going into it. But surely you can't prevent people from doing their job. Now, it is the job of courts, therefore, to look at the allegations in the FIR. There could be very many reasons why an FIR is registered. But once they look at the allegations in the FIR and come to the conclusion that they don't pass the the test of sustainability, then they should do something about it. So ultimately, whether there is a motive, whether it's a counter or not, sometimes it's a matter of trial, sometimes it's a matter of gathering evidence. There are different stages at which it is done. But essentially, an FIR must disclose the commission of a cognizable offense, and only then should a court proceed.
Thank you, ma'am. Chitranshu, this is for you. How will mens rea be evaluated while arrest to charge under sedition arrest?
That's the point. You cannot do that. You simply cannot do that. There's no way that, like ma'am said, that you cannot read someone's mind and what they're thinking, what they want to do. That's why I said that till the time there's a proper investigation, before that you cannot arrest anyone. And only after investigation, when you find that under stringent guidelines you can impose 124, and only then you can arrest anyone. There's no way of knowing it at the outset.
Thank you. And this has brought us to the end of the session, though we have many questions on various forums right now, but it's already time. So thank you, Justice Gupta. Thank you, Rebecca, ma'am. And thank you, Chitranshul, for sharing your thoughts, which I think all of us needed to hear, in spite of being, most of us are lawyers, yet I feel we needed to hear it from you. We needed to have this discussion, so that we can only feel more empowered, more enlightened. So thank you very much on behalf of all of us. And may God bless us all and keep our voices high.
Thank you for having me here.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
We'll have to just end the meeting now.
Thank you all. Okay, so we just leave, I guess.